So my next guest has written about his frontline experience in battling the coronavirus in his general practice and at a homeless clinic in Edinburgh, Scotland. In his book, Intensive Care, Dr. Gavin Francis is critical of the slow government response. This is what he wrote. We've been like toddlers on the beach, fascinated by the waves edging ever closer up the sand, but who still squeal with shock when the water rolls over our toes. None of us could be persuaded to jump back until the disease was already on us. Well, I want to bring in Dr. Francis, who's joining us now from Edinburgh, Scotland. Doctor, lovely to have you on the show. Thank you very much. You heard our reporter there from London. Are you supportive of the UK's borders being shut down? Is this a case of lessons learned and the government is no longer squealing at the water, rolling over its toes?
Absolutely. I mean, I personally would have wished that we'd done this months and months and months ago. You know, I've got friends that have been traveling in and out of China, and we see how quickly China managed to control the spread of the virus. So yeah, I wish we'd had mandatory testing right from the outset. I wish we'd had a way of obliging people to quarantine rather than leaving it up to their own conscience.
Where you are in Scotland has had tougher restrictions than some parts of England, for example. You've also seen the impact of these lockdowns on mental health, on routine screenings, school closings. It seems like it's been a binary choice between isolation or being sick. How difficult has that been to navigate as a doctor?
Yeah, it's been very difficult for me because, as you say, Robyn, I work in the community as a general practitioner, a family physician, and so right from the outset, my whole world has been turned upside down, but not as people might expect by having to deal with virus. I've had some patients die of the virus. I've had quite a few patients die of the virus and recover. Really, all of my patients' lives have been turned upside down by the restriction. And what I wanted to highlight in this book is the way that our lives have been so dominated, not by the virus itself, but by what we have had to do to control and restrain the virus. And in terms of mental health, that's been truly appalling. It's been really, really terrible, the rise in mental health problems from alcoholism, panic attack, adolescence, self-harm. This year has just been very, very difficult from that point of view.
And how have you managed that? Because you do write very powerfully about this, in many ways, how the pandemic is changing medicine for family doctors like you. You're into pastoral care, I suppose, on the ground there. So what has been the most difficult part of this?
Oh, well, you know, in medicine, we're taught to always see the patient, always examine the patient. It's a kind of maxim for the practice of medicine to feel like you're doing a good professional job is to cast your eye over things face to face. And the most pernicious aspect of this virus is the fact that it's got so many people spread it asymptomatically, and also that it's spread through the most basic elements of our humanity, you know, through touch, through voice. And so I normally would see 25 to 30 patients face to face in a day. And for the last year, I've only been able to see 5 or 6. And even that is behind visors, plastic, double pairs of gloves, minimum numbers of people allowed into the waiting room. And that has been the most extraordinary revolution in the way that we practice medicine. And it's one that I hope will not prove enduring, because I dearly, dearly want to get back to the way of practicing medicine that I was trained in and the way that I love, which is to see the patient.
When you, in the book, you talk about something that you call the great faff, which is actually having to put on the gloves and the mask and the apron, all the PPE for the patients that you do see. How does that change things, where you then having you not, this is not telemedicine, but then you also want to give someone a hug, or you're giving them bad news?
Oh, well, you can't, as I say. So, yeah, the part of the book that describes that, the great faff, is when part of my job involves going out and doing visits in people's homes to assess people who are housebound, too ill to be able to make it to the hospital for assessment. And in that case, you know, I have to speak to them on the phone first from the car outside the house. I have to ask them to come and sit as close to their own front door as possible so that I don't need to go into a potentially infective house all through the rooms to find them. I then have to, as you say, gown up with this plastic and visors and masks and 2 pairs of gloves, assessment as possible, and then have the conversation about what needs to happen over the telephone from outside, rather than spend time with the patient, maybe putting a hand on their shoulder, being able to support them in that way. Yeah, it's very difficult.
You work in Edinburgh, but I think your story is no doubt replicated across the world. What do you think doctors, what do you think is the commonality between your story and doctors around the world?
Yeah, I think we're all facing the same cataclysm, really, of this pandemic. It's been, no matter where you are, wherever you are, sub-Saharan Africa, East Asia, North or South America, Australasia, the virus is going to get to you the same way through an infected human contact. And it's going to affect the human body in the same way. And so there's a kind of... I've been really impressed, I suppose you should say, by a kind of fraternity of clinicians across the world, not just doctors, but nurses and all kinds of healthcare workers that have come together. I mean, the speed with which we've developed these vaccines, the speed with which knowledge has been shared in order to try and defeat this vaccine, this virus has been truly unprecedented, extraordinary.
Dr. Gavin Francis, thank you very much. The author of Intensive Care, it's a beautiful book, and thank you for all the work that I know that you're doing out there every single day. Appreciate it, Doctor.
Thanks, Robyn.
So coming up, Kamala Harris is making history. When we come back, a special sneak peek of our CNN special with the Vice President-elect.